Hello everybody and welcome to this webinar today on effective teaching methodologies for online learning and engaging the learner online. I really want to welcome you to this webinar and thank you for taking out time to attend this. Just a few more minutes so that people can join in. Great, I think we can get started now and people will join in as and when they do. So this global pandemic that we are all going through, this coronavirus closures, nobody had ever thought that a tiny virus will bring the powers that be to their knees. Never had we imagined that the malls, the parks, the markets that we take for granted will close down in a matter of hours, and we don't know when they're going to come back. And most of all, none of us have ever fathomed or thought that our schools, our colleges, our educational institutions will shut down, and in a matter of hours, they will completely move to the online medium. Namaskar. My name is Ritika Subhash. By profession, I am the head of operations of a London-based education technology firm called Mangahi. I worked in the area of bringing artificial intelligence and game-based learning to students for mathematics in the age range of 5 to 15, so grades 1 to 10. However, as a passion, I'm a story weaver and a storyteller. So today's session, I'm going to start with an interesting story, which I feel very few of you would have heard. This story is called the Chalkboard Revolution. All of us who are attending this webinar right now have one thing in common in our educational journeys, whether it was our school education or college education. We've all gone to classrooms that had chalkboards in them. But have you ever thought, where did these chalkboards come from? When did they originate? How did they start getting used in classrooms? So today, I'm going to share with you the history of chalkboard. And hence, this story is called the Chalkboard Revolution. Up until the end of 18th century, the way that children were learning in classrooms was they had individual slates with them, or they would write on wood. So wood was cheap. Paper and pen, ink, these were expensive items. So they used to have those individual slates on which they used to scribble their notes or write their problems. But this posed a very particular problem for the teachers. If a teacher had to communicate a question to the class, they wouldn't be able to do or reach even the last child in the classroom. So many times the teachers had to walk and write the problem on every child's slate individually. As you can imagine, that was a very inefficient use of their time. So in the year 1801, a geography teacher and headmaster of the old high school in Edinburgh, he found a very interesting solution to this problem. He took a piece of big slate and he hung it in the front of the classroom. And that marks the humble beginning of the chalkboard, which we also call the blackboard. From there, it spread to other parts of the world, the UK, the US, and today it is almost unimaginable to think about a classroom without a chalkboard. It has evolved over a period of time, whiteboards have come in, but the idea remains the same. But when there is a revolution, can revolt be far behind? Yes, there was a revolt against chalkboards. Can you believe it? Who would revolt against a chalkboard? It's hard to imagine, right? You will actually find it even more hard to realize that this revolt was done by the scholars of Yale University. Yes, the scholars of Yale University revolted against the chalkboard in the early 1820s. This was known as the chalkboard revolt. It was also famously known as the conic sections revolt, because the chapter that these children didn't, or these students, young students, didn't want to do on the blackboard was the conic sections. The reason they were revolting was when they were answering these questions on their slates, they could refer to their other textbooks, they could look at the other books and be able to figure out the answer. But when they were asked to do these problems in front on the blackboard, on the chalkboard, they found it intimidating. So in 1820s, a group of 38 students revolted against the chalkboard. They were suspended. However, later they put in a written apology to the university and they were reinstated back. But this was not the end of the revolt. 5 years later, another class of 43 students again revolted against the chalkboard. But this time the university expelled all of them, and that brought the revolt to a screeching halt. And since then, we know that the chalkboard has stood the test of time. It has traveled across continents, across countries, and it has proven its efficacy. So I hope you enjoyed that little tidbit of history and that information about chalkboard, this humble piece of equipment that we see so often but don't really realize the kind of struggle it has gone through to come to our homes and our classrooms. So the other reason why I'm telling you this story is that I feel that today online education is at the exact same juncture where chalkboard education was about 200 years ago. Even though this pandemic has made online education a sort of a necessity, a norm, but still there are a lot of apprehensions about this medium to learn. Teachers are apprehensive about how to use this to the best of its ability. Parents are apprehensive about excessive screen time. Children are apprehensive because they may not be fully engaged in just an online lesson. So it is up to us now to make the best use of this situation and move towards using this tool or this resource to its maximum best potential. If we are using this tool just to use the webcam feature of our system and to use a video conferencing tool to be in front of our classroom, I feel that is a suboptimal use of this technology. Power of technology lies in two parts. The first is it has the ability to engage all the senses of the learner. So if you have auditory learners, if you have visual learners, if you have kinesthetic learners, it doesn't matter. The online medium has something to offer for every kind of learner. And the second biggest ability of technology is for it to be able to cater to every learning need and personalize that content according to every child. Unless as teachers we are using both of these, you can say the effects or impacts of technology, it is a real suboptimal use and rather a disservice to our class to be able to do that. So today in this webinar, I'm going to cover the four pillars of learning, or the four pillars on which you should base your online lesson planning and deliver a very effective lesson, because we know that distance learning is going to be a norm for a very long time to come. So how do we utilize it to the best? I'm going to show various aspects of this kind of lesson planning in this PowerPoint today. So I'm going to switch towards showing you something. I think you should be able to see now. Right. So this is my slide. These are my slides for effective online teaching methodologies. The four pillars that I was talking to you a while back regarding keeping these in mind while making an online lesson are very simple but very powerful. Are you ready to see this? The first pillar is when you're making your online lesson, have something for your class to see. The second pillar is have something for your class to hear. The third pillar is have something for your class to do. And the fourth pillar is have something to celebrate in that lesson. Now I'm going to pause on the screen for about 3 or 4 seconds because this is where you're going to get the most out of what you're trying to get in this particular video. I'd also like to mention that I introduced all of these four one by one, not all together. The reason I did that is to ensure that I am able to balance the cognitive load. At any point in time, our brains can only hold a limited amount of information, and of course in growing children, in children that is even lesser. So have bite-sized chunks of information for them so that they are able to absorb and take the best of the content and not get overwhelmed with words on your PowerPoint or your slide. So coming to the first pillar, having something to see. In an online medium, when you're conducting a class, there are largely two things that your class will see. The first thing is they will see you, of course, because you're going to be there in front of them on the webcam. And the other thing that they will see is your screen, like you are seeing my screen right now. So when they're able to see you, the idea is that for you to be able to fully be present in that class, physically, emotionally, and also be presentable. So come to your class, come to your online lesson just as you would in your actual class. Also, you can keep the same expectation from your students where they are coming to the class dressed properly and not coming in their night gear, and making sure that there is some semblance of, discipline and some semblance of, classroom feel, even though everybody is at their home. The second thing that the students will see is your screen. Now imagine this, your screen becomes a personalized chalkboard for every single child. How powerful is that? Every child has become a front bencher in this online teaching and learning ecosystem. Isn't that very powerful? You don't have any more backbenchers. You do not have any students who are away from you or the content that you're trying to share. And this is something that you need to leverage to your advantage. So let's see this with an example. Let's see some operations on fractions. Since I'm a maths person, I'm going to show you an example, which is very, very common. Fractions is a common pain point for students. But it can be made very interesting in your online lesson. So have a scribble board or a blackboard in front of your kids, and suppose you give them a question to do in your online class. 1/2 divided by, and pardon my poor writing skills, 1/2 divided by 1/4. So here is the question. Now there are different ways for you to approach it while you are taking an online class, right? One way to do it is the traditional way in which all of us have learned, which is very rote, that you take 1/2, you change the sign of the operation, you can actually reverse the other fraction so it becomes 4/1 instead of 1/4. And now since we all know our times table very well, we know that we can get the answer 2, and that's it. That's the answer. That is one way to teach. But the other way to do it is to get them to understand conceptually what is happening here. You can actually draw any item and tell them that fractions are always a part of a whole. They are equal parts of a whole. So if I have a bar of chocolate here, I can divide it into 2 equal halves. Again, pardon my poor drawing. So I can divide this bar of chocolate into 2 equal halves, or I can divide it into 4 equal quarters. Now what this question is essentially asking me is that how many quarters are there in a half? If I divide this half into quarters, how many quarters will I have? So if I'm looking at this particular half, there is one quarter and there is two quarters. So the answer is two. Now, how simply we have done a very difficult topic. Operations on fractions is a huge pain point with kids, but somehow they go through the system by rote memorizing this particular system that we do, reversing of the operations and then reversing of the fraction. But here, pictorially, because the children are physically in front of you and they're close to your board, you can use this medium and you can leverage that power of closeness to show them pictorially in many other ways that there is the concept of whatever you're trying to teach. I'm taking an example of maths and fractions. You can teach any particular topic, chemistry, physics, even the sciences, arts, anything that you want to teach through this particular medium. So now I'm going back to the slide where I left you. So this was the first pillar, which is having something for your class to see. Now I'm coming to the second pillar, which is having something for your class to hear. The reason that I actually started off this webinar with a story was I wanted to get your attention. I wanted to bring you at ease and ensure that you are going to have a good time in this particular class or this lesson or this webinar. I wanted to engage that auditory learner within you. Every one of us is a mix of every kind of learner. We are all some part auditory, some part kinesthetic, some part visual. So I wanted to get that auditory learner in you engaged with my lesson. The reason I feel is there is always emotion before cognition. If we want our children to be cognitively available to us, to be able to grasp the concept that we are trying to tell them, we have to first catch them emotionally to be present with us. And that will only happen when you become a storyteller, when you become somebody who authentically shares what you know, your wisdom, through a medium which engages them. So have something to hear, like I had this little story in this webinar. The next pillar, which is a very important pillar, is having something for your class to do. Now, when I'm talking about this having to do something, I'm talking about it from the perspective of neuroscience of learning. And when we talk about neuroscience of learning, we have to talk about thinking, attention, and memories. So I'm going to bring your attention to these three key points and then get you to understand why it is important for every child to be able to do something during an online lesson or even offline. So, talking about thinking, there are two systems of thinking in our brain. One is called the system one thinking, which is fast thinking, and the other is called system two thinking, which is slow thinking. The system one thinking is its characteristics are that it is a fast thinking, effortless, unconscious, and automatic way of thinking. The system two thinking in theory is slow thinking, it's effortful, it's conscious, logical, and deliberative. So now I've given you the theory of system one and system two thinking, but I want to now share with you the practical aspect of it and get you to understand and experience system one and system two thinking. So in the next few slides, I'm going to give you some problems, and don't worry, these are very easy problems. You will know the answers within a fraction of a second. All I want you to do is make a note, a mental note of the answer, and keep it with you. So here I go. I have the next five slides for you. So here is where the buck stops. In the first four slides, what you were experiencing was fast thinking. We have all done our times table very well during our classroom, and that part of our understanding was very strong, and hence we knew the answers immediately. Whereas when we came to this slide, we know what we have to do. We know that we have to multiply 17 with 24. We know that the answer is something that we can get to, but it is effortful. It is deliberate effort. We know that we can easily multiply, we can do the carryover, we can do the operations on units and tens and thousands and so on and so forth, but it is taking us time to do that. This is the system to thinking. And don't worry, the answer is 408. I know a lot of you must be fretting about what the answer is all about, and science has proven that your pupils actually contract back to normal once you have a solution to your problem. So there's a lot of physiological experiences that one has as they are solving problems. Coming to the second part, which is attention. You have 30, 40 kids join in on an online class, but all of them may be at a different level of attention at every point in time. The first image that you see is that of diffused attention. Within diffused attention, your brain is actually working in a way where you are tapping into various parts of your brain. You are actually getting information from different parts of the brain. You're getting more creative, and you are finding solutions to your problems in a sort of a longish way. In the second visual, that is a representation of focused attention, where you are simply focusing on a problem and you're not looking left, right, and center, and you're just doing that. It's not to say that one way of learning or attention is better than the other. Both have their own advantages. In fact, Professor Barbara Oakley, who has done a lot of research on the science of learning how to learn, she has one of the world's most popular online courses called Learning How to Learn. She has actually said in many of her talks that most of the successful scientists, artists, musicians in history have used their diffused attention and diffused thinking mode to get creative ideas or solutions to the problems, and then they bring their attention towards a focused point to be able to verbalize it or finalize what they are thinking. So I just wanted to bring your attention to the fact that within your classroom you will have the children who are either in diffused or in focused attention or moving from one to the other. So that is also something that you need to be cognitive of while doing an online lesson planning. And the third thing is memories, because the reason we have to talk about memories in neuroscience of learning is because when we are teaching a lesson, whether it is online or in person, the idea that we are teaching with is that we want the child or the learner to have that information go into his or her long-term memory. The two parts in which I divide memory, or which the science says memory is divided into, is your short-term or working memory and then long-term memory. When you have some sort of sensory input, it goes into your short-term memory. If you practice it over a period of time, so if you do a lot of revision and rehearsal of whatever it is that you're trying to deal with, whatever short-term problem that is, there are chances that the few of the 86 billion neurons in your brain will start firing and they'll start wiring together. So this firing and wiring of neurons leads to linkages, and these linkages, if they are strong enough, they go from the short-term memory into long-term memory. So when you were trying to do that math problem, you had done a lot of practice of simple multiplication when you were children. So that link of how to do multiplication or remembering your times table had gone into your long-term memory. All you had to do was go and fetch it from your long-term memory when you got your problem. Whereas there are things that have to be practiced again and again to be able to get them to that position. They will not move into long-term memory. It's very hard to get things into long-term memory, but once they're there for good. So this is where the rehearsal and the drill and the practice and the grit and the perseverance of students needs to be developed. Of course, there will be some forgetting in between as a process, but that is the whole idea of getting anything into long-term memory, and that's why you are teaching a class, whether you're teaching it online or offline. And the reason I'm covering all of this is simple. To have synaptic plasticity in your brain, which means to make sure that your neurons are firing and they're wiring together, your brain is growing, you're learning new things versus synaptic pruning, which means that all the things that you're not practicing are essentially getting washed away or cleared away from your brain. And that's something that we don't want if we are trying to teach a concept to the children. So the idea here is let them do activities on their own, even during the live class. Just because you are on an online medium, you do not have to give a didactic class for the full 15 minutes or 1 hour or however long you're doing it. Even in a regular classroom, you do pose problems to the class and give them some silent time to work on those problems. The same has to be followed for an online class because they need that time to be able to get into a sort of a struggle, because productive struggle is where they will get their aha moments. That's where they will actually get to understand what is happening and what they are learning versus something that is just being told to them. This is where their thinking, their attention and their memory, all three of these will combine and transfer that knowledge to long-term memory if the synapses or the synaptic plasticity is strong. So to give you an example of this, of course you can give them worksheets to work on during the online class. You can actually use online tools. So I'm going to show you here one tool. Again, since we were discussing fractions earlier, so I'm going to take the example of fractions. So while you're doing an online lesson, you can tell the class to log on to whatever platform you're using for learning and get them to play a game on fractions. So here the game is that I have to arrange these fractions in the correct order. And if I do that, then my flower will blossom. But if I don't do that, suppose I don't do that, then my flower will die. So here I'm actually struggling as a child to get the answers correct, to move it to the right position. But that productive struggle is where I'm actually learning versus somebody just telling me that this is the way fractions need to be arranged. So again, many tools that you can use for this, and try to get creative and understand how you can use or what is the best tool for you and your students and your school to be able to do a rigorous practice of questions, of problems, and of finding solutions to those problems. So this is the third pillar, which is have something to do for your class. And lastly, the most important pillar I feel is have something for your class, for your students to celebrate in every class. And the only thing that I would request you for to celebrate day after day, class after class, is mistakes and failure. Professor Jo Bowler, she's one of my most favorite researchers and authors. She's done a lot of work on understanding mathematics anxiety and why do children actually fail or fear math. And a lot of her research is groundbreaking because she has found that every time a child makes a mistake in math, they grow a synapse, which means that their neurons are firing and wiring every single time that a child makes mistakes in maths. This is very powerful because traditionally, as parents, as teachers, we have always been very, very negative towards mistakes and failures. And Jo Bowler actually goes to the extent of saying that give mistakes and failures, give wrong answers equal, if not more weightage than correct answers, because somebody who's getting the answers wrong is actually, they're actually struggling, but they're also finding alternate pathways to answers which may be incorrect. So those need to be really commended. Also, you can get two or three kids in every online class to share their mistakes, because once they share their mistakes, they become more verbal about what they're going through. And other peers, other students in their class learn from the mistakes of their peers. The other thing that this does is it makes them recall what they have learned. And Professor Barbara Oakley has mentioned time and again that the best way to retain information and to convert information into knowledge is to recall it or to teach it to somebody else. And if you can do this class after class, which is have something for them, for your class to see, have something for them to hear, have something for them to do, and something for them to celebrate, and you repeat it over and over again, you will see phenomenal success in the way your class is responding to your lessons, in the way they are absorbing those lessons, and they move forward. Lastly, I wanted to show you this very interesting picture from Joe Bowler's book, Mathematical Mindsets. And it's a very powerful technique that she uses to inculcate a love for mistakes. What she does is she gets children or students in her class to crumple a piece of paper, really crumple it into a ball, and then throw it, and then bring that paper back, iron it out a little, and then put a little icon of my brain right in between. And she makes them color those little veins that have been created through the crumpling process. And she tells them that your brain grows every time you make a mistake. So keep this paper with you throughout the school year as a reminder of how much you are learning through the process of making mistakes and through failure. So my humble request to all teachers, educators, and parents here is, let's befriend the idea of mistakes and failure and be okay with it. So at the end, I would like to summarize all the things that I've talked about. And the reason for me to do this webinar in this way was that I introduced the topic with a story first. So I had something for you to hear. I showed you the working of a problem. So when I did that 1/2 divided by 1/4, I actually showed you a problem, for something for you to focus on. I got you to try some problems yourself. So when you did those multiplications, and when you stopped at a particular multiplication, you were going through productive struggle yourself. So you did something on your own, even during this webinar. And lastly, I hope that I got you to befriend failure and mistakes. So these are the four pillars of effective online teaching. I really hope and pray that we all get over this pandemic soon. However, whether we do or not, these techniques are going to be powerful whether you use it in your lesson planning for online teaching or offline teaching. So I thank you all for attending this Facebook Live. I thank Shreshth Kala Sangam for arranging this webinar. And I hope this has been useful for all those attending. So I will try and go back to the live session if there are any questions. Just end the live video. Thank you, everybody.